Hi, I'd like to say thank you for everybody for coming out today to today's presentation. Now, this is presentation for the 7090 course, which is leveraging IS in business, but it opened it up to a wider group. We've got the IS group here, some undergrads are here for the presentation. Now, when I started this semester with 7090, it started out just as a normal class, but made a lot of changes. We invited several industry speakers, and instead of having a class, I feel like we've gone on this long journey through emerging technologies, and we got really in depth in a lot of different technologies over the course of the semester. We had industry speakers that gave different perspectives, and it's all culminated up to this point, and now we have our keynote speaker, which is Jack Shaw, that's going to come and finish out the semester for us today. And so with Jack Shaw, he's an innovative and technology strategist with over 30 years experience helping leaders transform their organizations to anticipate and manage strategic disruptions. Jack has advised key decision makers at dozens of trade associations and professional societies, as well as Fortune 500 companies such as Mercedes-Benz, Bosch, Coca-Cola, Johnson & Johnson, IBM, Oracle, and SAP. His decades of experience designing, developing, and implementing emerging technologies enable him to speak with a unique perspective on artificial intelligence, blockchain, 5G, and the Internet of Things. Jack integrates his executive experience in industry, technology, and consulting to speak on innovation, change management, and transformational leadership. A global thought leader, he was voted one of the world's top 25 professional speakers and one of the top 5 technology futurists. Jack has shared his insights and advice with nearly 300,000 of the world's top leaders and professionals in 26 countries and every state. He's a Yale University graduate with an MBA from Kellogg. And so without further ado, I would like to welcome Jack Shaw. Thank you.
And now, coming to us from the depths of cyberspace, please welcome our speaker, Jack Shaw.
Whoa! And here we are, and there you are, live and in 3D. I have to say, traveling through cyberspace is fun. You should try it sometime. We've asked a special guest to join us in person here at Exhibitor Live in Las Vegas. So please, join me in welcoming to our stage, well, me. Thank you, Jack. Thanks for inviting me to open the program. Well, you did a great job. I couldn't have done it any better myself. But I think I can take it from here. It was my pleasure. And thanks to our attendees. I hope you all have a great conference. Beam me up, Scotty. Anybody ever get the feeling that sometimes you're just talking to yourself?
Yeah, it's funny, I have had that feeling. Sometimes I feel like there's two or three of me and I still can't keep up with everything. Well, that was the opening of a presentation I did just a couple of weeks ago at a conference in Las Vegas called Exhibitor Live, which was a conference for the conference and events industry itself. And one of the things we were doing, what we were doing there was a live demonstration of holopresence technology, holographic telepresence. So most of the people that were in the audience that day did not realize that that was a pre-recorded hologram of me, until I actually walked onto the stage at the same time and they sort of put it together. Later we'll talk more about this kind of advanced technology and some of the broader implications that it has. But let me start by sharing with you simply that as a technology futurist and innovation and technology strategist for coming up on 40 years now, I have often been asked to make predictions about the future. And whenever I do, I always try to keep in mind the words of that great American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who put it so well when he said, making predictions is very hard, especially about the future. Nevertheless, I'm going to go out on a limb tonight and make some predictions and share some ideas with you. But let me emphasize that he was absolutely correct. In fact, some of the leading experts in their fields, some of the giants of their industries, have made some predictions that in retrospect turn out to be, well, less than completely accurate. Let me give you an example. Going all the way back to the 1940s, Daryl Zanuck, the famed film producer and co-founder of 20th Century Fox, said that television won't be able to hold on to any market it captures after the first 6 months. People will soon get tired of staring at a plywood box every night. Now, for those of you under 30, I should probably explain that what he meant by a plywood box is that televisions didn't used to be flat and hang on the, well, you've probably seen pictures in the history books, so anyway, I think you'll see what I'm getting at. Why is it only the people over 30 are the ones laughing? 1977, Ken Olson, founder and CEO of Digital Equipment Corporation, world's largest manufacturer of the first mini computers, the first really successful computers that didn't require whole rooms the size of this one, mainframe-based computers, said, there is no reason for any individual to have a computer in his home. 15 years later, Digital Equipment Corporation was acquired by a personal computer manufacturing company, Compaq. It's not just that people make mistakes that, or excuse me, predictions that turn out to be disastrously wrong, but not understanding how emerging technology might impact your business, your industry, can have much greater economic impacts on your business. This is the Queen Elizabeth, the original QE1 in this case, for those of you ocean liner fans who are keeping count. For 50 years in the first part of the 20th century, she and her sister ocean liners dominated the market for transatlantic passenger transportation. If you wanted to travel, say, from New York to London, you went by ship. Now, it had become possible by the late 1930s to fly commercially across the ocean. But as the executives of any of the ocean liner companies would have told you, what self-respecting person would ever want to subject themselves to 16 to 30 hours of cold, cramped, noisy, vibrating discomfort when traveling by ship, they could ride in comfort, indeed in opulence, and arrive at their destination in less than a week? No, they would have said, passengers will never forego the luxury of crossing the ocean by ship. And so it was. Until August of 1957, when Pan American Airlines introduced Boeing 707 nonstop jet service from New York to London in 8 hours. And in 6 months, the ocean transatlantic passenger industry lost 90% of its customers. And yet this was a technology that had already been around for more than 50 years since the Wright brothers had flown at Kitty Hawk. But only when it reached a level of maturity and acceptance did it dramatically impact a major industry, which has recovered in many respects, but in completely different ways, where they now understand that for passengers, traveling by ship is about tourism and cruises and fun. It's not about simply getting from point A to point B. So let's take a look into the future. This is Luke and Annie, and they're both very excited. Annie's new business is going quite well. In addition, Luke has recently gotten a promotion and a raise at his job, and they've decided they're ready to buy their first house. Now, this is just a few years down the road from now, so things work a little bit differently. They don't buy a house and then go looking for a loan. Instead, what they do is they make their online credit history available to lenders who lend for houses, mortgages, in the price range that they're interested in, and solicit bids from the lenders to offer them mortgages. And after reviewing a number of those online pre-approved mortgages up to a certain amount at a given rate and so forth, they decide that now we know what we can do. We're ready to start shopping for houses. Of course, we start not by driving all over the metro area, but by virtual reality tours of a number of houses we pre-qualified, looking at them inside and out, and making a decision on which one we think is the one we most likely would want to purchase. Once we've made that decision, and we know what the asking price is, we decide, yes, of course, we are going to go visit that house now in person. While they're on the way to the house, they contact their first choice of lender and tell them to go ahead and conduct a title search on the house. Now, back in ancient history, like in 2021, having a title search done would have taken weeks. But in this case, they get to the house, they look around, they find it is just as nice as they had hoped. They talk with the owners, they negotiate a price, agree on terms and conditions, and because the title search has already been completed by this time within minutes, they close the deal via digital signatures, facial recognition, and thumbprints on their flexible smartphones. No paperwork, no brokers, no attorneys. And in fact, no keys are even required because access to the house and all of its systems are now under their control via their biometrics or will be on the agreed upon date of possession that they and the sellers have determined. Second scenario, the latest generation of passenger jet pauses for a moment at the end of the runway at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris before being cleared for takeoff on a nonstop flight to Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport in Atlanta. Several hours later, far out over the North Atlantic, a sensor embedded in one of its engines, jet fuel injectors, detects that that jet fuel injector has incurred an inordinate amount of wear and that it will have to be replaced earlier than normal maintenance schedules would have allowed for, would have required, and therefore that it will have to be replaced on arrival at Hartsfield prior to the return flight to Paris. Now, the problem is this is a very expensive part that rarely needs to be replaced. And therefore, it's not kept in stock at Hartsfield. In fact, again, in earlier days, it would have required that part to be flown in from another airport or flown in from a vendor. And that would have caused considerable delay in the departure of the return flight at great expense to the airline and great inconvenience to the passengers. But not so. The Internet of Things technology embedded in the jet fuel injector communicates with the aircraft's equipment maintenance system, which in turn sends information to the airline's procurement system, saying that we will need this part on arrival. The airline's procurement system launches an intelligent procurement agent out onto the internet looking for sources of this particular jet fuel injector certified for use by the FAA with this engine on this particular aircraft. It identifies several such providers, some of which are current suppliers to the airline, others which the airline does not yet have a working relationship for. And when it negotiates terms and conditions and finds the best comes from a new vendor, it then solicits from that vendor confirmation of the quality and reliability both of the parts that they provide and of their service and timeliness of delivery, support, and so forth. Once they have completed that process, the intelligent procurement agent negotiates and closes an online smart contract with that vendor, on completion of which the vendor makes accessible to the airline a download of the design for a 3D printing of that particular part. The part is 3D printed at Hartsfield-Jackson Airport, finished off, and delivered to the gate an hour before the aircraft arrives. The entire process, from the time that the aircraft's jet fuel injectors, sensors detected the inordinate amount of wear, through the determination to purchase the new part, identifying and establishing a relationship with a new vendor to do that, negotiating the terms and conditions of the purchase of that part, and downloading the design for that part to the 3D printer, has required a grand total of 4 minutes. And the aircraft then, the part is installed while the aircraft is being serviced, refueled, passengers disembarked, new passengers going on, and it leaves on time without a single minute's delay on its return flight to Paris, and many more safe and reliable international round trips as a result. Now, what is it that enables these levels of innovation in processes, businesses, industries, whether it's airline equipment maintenance, whether it's residential real estate acquisition, or any other industry or business you can think of? Well, a host of technologies can come into play. These transformational technologies include things like 3D printing, blockchain, augmented and virtual reality, biometrics, and one of perhaps the most significant is artificial intelligence. Now, there's a lot of misunderstandings about artificial intelligence, especially in the broad community. People think of artificial intelligence all too often as being, you know, killer robots running wild and slaughtering all the humans. But it's interesting. When I was taking my MBA courses 150 years ago, no, it wasn't quite that long ago, but it was over 40 years ago, people used to talk about artificial intelligence in terms of what it might be able to do in the future. They said, you know, someday we may have artificial intelligence so smart that an AI could actually beat a human being at checkers. They also used to say, we may have artificial intelligence someday so smart that you will be able to talk to it and it will understand what you say and transcribe your voice into words. Now, how many people think of voice recognition as artificial intelligence? We don't think, we think it's voice recognition, right? We use it all the time, dictating texts, right? But that was considered an advanced form of AI. The bar keeps moving in terms of what AI constitutes. One important way to think about AI, though, in businesses and organizations, in any case, is as an evolutionary continuum. And particularly when it comes to making business decisions, it's an extension of data analytics. Data analytics has three levels. One is what's called descriptive analytics, sometimes also referred to as business intelligence. Now, this has been around for probably 30 years as such. And what it's really about, what it really refers to, and it's much more widely available now, although amazingly enough, There are still many, many organizations around the world that lack timely, accurate business intelligence. The idea is that as soon as information is updated in any of the systems anywhere in the business, you ought to be able to have summary information that can access that and give people timely, accurate information that's up to date. People say to me, Jack, what do we need to do to be able to predict the future? All too often, these are people who can't even predict the present. They're trying to make decisions based on information that's hours to days to weeks to even months out of date in some cases, then wondering why their decisions don't produce the results that they're looking for. Well, the next step beyond descriptive analytics is predictive analytics. Now you actually are trying to project forward. You're looking at those things where the trends and circumstances are such that you can reliably make a prediction that if this is what the historical curve looks like, here's what the likely extension of that will be in the future. And if things continue unchanged, here are the outcomes that are likely to result from that. That leads into the next step of data analytics, which is one that is really on the verge of what we can more broadly consider to be AI, which is prescriptive analytics. With prescriptive analytics, you're going beyond simply saying, what do we think that is likely to happen in the future based on what has happened in the past, to saying, if what's likely to happen is not the ideal outcome that we would like to have, then what do we need to do differently to change that likely outcome to be something that's closer to what we are looking for? And AI comes with a lot of different kinds of technologies that are coming into play. If you stop and look, particularly at mid-sized to large organizations, you've got business infrastructure, internal systems, and outward-facing systems generating huge amounts of data, structured data coming out of internal automated systems of all kinds, unstructured data coming from sources like emails, social media posts, and other data. Natural language processing is a form of AI which can take that unstructured data and apply a meaningful structure to it for analytical purposes, as input along with structured data to tools like associative memory, which can be used for pattern recognition, and combined with tools like machine learning and robotic process automation, so that you can create intelligent agents that are able to think, decide, and even act to solve business problems in ways similar to the ways that experienced human experts in the field would address the same problems. Now, an intelligent agent is not going to be able to make a decision as well as a person that has been spending 20 years of their life and career and experience in focusing on and understanding that area. But they're going to be able to analyze the data around it way faster. And by continuing to feed the results of the decisions that have been made and the outcomes that resulted back into the systems to refine them, they get smarter and smarter and smarter every time they make a decision. And they get faster. And they may only work at a level of 80 to 90% of what your top, best, most experienced people can do. But that's a challenge that a lot of companies have. Because in most organizations, and those of you, how many people here are working full-time and working on your MBA at night? Okay, looks like a majority, at least the ones in Dr. French's class. Okay. And so I'm sure you would agree from your observations that in most organizations, the best decisions, the most results are handled by a handful of experts. The old 80-20 rule, that 20% of the best people produce 80% of the best results. Now, wouldn't it be great if you could take those 20% top experts and have them look over the shoulders of the other 80% of the people who are perhaps less knowledgeable or less experienced or younger or whatever, and coach them to get them up to speed so they can make those decisions as well and accurately and with as much experience. Of course, the problem is in most companies, you can't afford to take the best people off doing their job on a full-time basis to coach the others. So people who are just getting started in whatever it is have to learn by trial and way too much error. But with intelligent agent technologies, you can leverage that expert knowledge across the rest of the organization because you can have intelligent agent technologies so that when that younger or less experienced person is working with that system, making those decisions or a recommendation, the technology might just come back and say, are you sure that's what you want to do? Because one likely outcome of this decision would be this undesirable result. Still giving the human authorized to do so the authority to be able to say, yeah, because there are some extenuating factors here, I think I made the right decision. But all too often to say, oh, that's right, I forgot about thus and so. Okay, yes, boy, am I glad I had somebody helping me out. Not the 20-year experienced person who can't be afforded to be taken off of her or his job, but an intelligent software agent. But it's not just a matter of getting younger or less experienced people up to speed more quickly. It's also about helping those very best people. Because right now, those very best people who make the very best decisions using their judgment, creativity, and experience spend 80% of their time gathering the information and crunching the numbers that they need to have in order to then apply all that experience and judgment and knowledge they've acquired for so many years. If instead you have an intelligent agent technology system in place to do that information gathering and number crunching for them, you dramatically improve the productivity of your top, best, most experienced people at the same time. So the evolution toward broad-based intelligent agent technology is going to be bringing about tremendous changes as we apply a range of AI tools and technologies across our infrastructures and across other enabling emerging technologies that I'll be touching on. Just to give you some examples of this, imagine AIs so clever that they can schedule production based on optimal machine performance at any particular point in time. Monitor performance data for each piece of equipment if it's at a manufacturing company. Assign the right repair technicians to the right job at the right time. Translate that into healthcare. Assign the right healthcare givers in, say, a large hospital to the right procedures at the right time. Coordinate deliveries with real-time traffic information. Either even predict product line sales sooner and more accurately than humans trying to track this are going to predict it so that you can scale production up and down to meet the demands of the market so that if you have sudden changes in demand and difficulties in supply, you don't end up with supply chain problems that cause drastic issues with availability of products and costs of products, although who could imagine such a thing going on? Of course, one of the challenges is a lot of people say, oh, I don't know this AI thing. The robots are going to come and take all of our jobs. No, it's not that simplistic either. So here is the good news. The good news is AI will not replace business decision makers. The bad news for some of you, although hopefully not too many of you, but for a lot of people in business today, is that business decision makers who know how to use AI-enabled tools and technologies will replace those who don't. So, understand and think creatively about how these technologies can help address issues and solve problems, especially some of the big issues we're dealing with now, like the huge supply chain issues that are going on a global basis. Now, another technology that those of you in Dr. French's class have spent a lot of time studying, the rest of you, probably a lot of you know a lot about it. Some of you probably don't know so much about it, but I can share with you definitely that in the business world as a whole, although by this time most people have heard about this, They don't really understand it or get it very well. And this is something that emerged at the height of the last Great Recession. In fact, you can actually date it to October 31st, Halloween, of 2008, when a paper was published on the internet by a person or group of people, still as yet unidentified, but written under the pseudonym of Satoshi Nakamoto. And that paper described how, by leveraging a combination of cryptographic and synchronization technologies, you could create for the first time a digital currency viable as both a store of value and a means of exchange. The paper refers to this digital currency as Bitcoin. And the set of enabling underlying technologies rapidly came to be known as blockchain. Now, it's incredibly important to understand the distinction between Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies in general and blockchain. And for those of you that already understand this stuff pretty well, think of this as a guide to how to explain it to those people that need to understand it and don't. Bitcoin is one, cryptocurrencies more generally, are one of thousands of potential applications of the underlying core technology called blockchain. What is it that makes blockchain so important? Four things. One is that blockchains allow you to create records that are permanent, immutable, signed, and time-stamped. Secondly, those records can be records of identity of people or things, and by extension, organizations, ownership of assets, both tangible physical assets and intangible assets, such as intellectual property. Also, for those of you that are into it, such things as non-fungible tokens. Records of business transactions and contractual commitments. Secondly, those records can be shared among any two or more entities in a given business or social ecosystem without any of those entities, people or organizations, having to depend on a third-party intermediary to confirm the validity and accuracy of those records. You don't have to have a government agency authorizing it. You don't have to have a bank confirming it. You've got agreement among two or more entities about what that information is. And it becomes globally available with complete transparency to everyone who is authorized to see it. And that subset of people who are authorized to see that information, that are authorized to update it by adding more or additional information, also can do so quickly and easily from anywhere in the world. And at the same time, it provides unhackable security against those unauthorized to update that information or even to see that information. Now, as soon as I use the word unhackable, the hackles go up on the back of a lot of people's necks because they say, well, wait a minute, Jack, how can that be? Isn't it true that given enough time and resources, any computer system can be hacked? I mean, look at this, the Equifax customer credit database, the Target credit card database, and all of these other systems. Almost anything can be hacked. How could it be unhackable? Well, this is because blockchain is not stored. Blockchain records or information are not stored on any computer system. They're stored on many computer systems. Identical copies of the information are stored on anywhere from dozens to hundreds to thousands of systems or nodes all over the world, And these nodes are each under tightly controlled security. Sometimes they're in the cloud, sometimes they're behind firewalls. So in order for a hacker to be able to hack into a blockchain, for example, and change data in some way that illicitly provides an advantage to that hacker, they would have to be able to hack into a majority of the nodes on that blockchain. But these blockchains synchronize frequently. The oldest and slowest blockchain, the Bitcoin blockchain, synchronizes every 10 minutes. Some of the financial blockchains synchronize every fraction of a second. And every time they resynchronize, any efforts that hackers have made to try to hack into that blockchain have to start all over again. And consequently, you're in a situation where they not only have to hack into dozens or hundreds or thousands of nodes, they have to do it all simultaneously, and they have to finish all of the hacks and the changes and the updates to those identically before the next synchronization takes place, in anywhere from minutes to seconds. Now, what does this take? Well, a few years ago, a Harvard physics professor did a sort of back of the envelope estimate to try to figure out what it would take to hack the Bitcoin blockchain. And what he tried to determine was what would be the amount of energy that would be required to drive the amount of computing power that would be needed to simultaneously hack a majority of the 7,000 nodes on the Bitcoin blockchain and complete the entire task before the next synchronization took place in 10 minutes' time. And his estimate came up that the amount of energy that would be needed to do this was approximately equal to the same amount of energy emitted during that 10 minutes by the sun. Now, some of you are probably thinking, so you could do it then. I mean, yes, you can write down a mathematical expression with enough exponentials in it to describe, you know, what would be the possibility of successfully hacking the Bitcoin blockchain, or by extension, all other properly implemented blockchains. Now, for those of you that are already into studying blockchains, let me clarify a couple of points. First of all, I'm talking about hacking the actual blockchain itself. I'm not talking about taking advantage of poorly written smart contracts that might be running on that blockchain. For those of you that are not into it, we'll talk about smart contracts in a few minutes. Okay? Some of you have probably said, well, what's this I hear about people getting their Bitcoin stolen, right? Isn't that hacking the blockchain? No, it's not. In almost every case where people have lost Bitcoin, it's because they buy Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies in some cases, and then they leave those cryptocurrency holdings resident in single computer online cryptocurrency exchanges, which, while well protected, are still on a single node, single computer, subject to being hacked. And when on those occasions they are successfully hacked and the Bitcoin addresses or other cryptocurrency ownership keys are controlled, suddenly people who had cryptocurrency on that exchange no longer have it. Somebody else owns it now. But the underlying blockchain has not been successfully hacked for Bitcoin, nor am I aware, after, in my case, some 7 years of following blockchain very closely, of any examples of well-implemented blockchains that have been successfully hacked. It just raises the level of security to so much higher level than we've ever had available to us previously that it enables a whole other class of applications beyond things that we could reliably do on the internet before. For example, why not electronic medical records? 25 years ago, when the internet first started being widely used for commercial applications, one of the first things people said was, oh my gosh, finally, we'll all be able to have our electronic medical records online on the internet and access it, and that's why by the time we get to the year 2015 or 2020, nobody will ever have to fill out forms when they go to the doctor's office again, updating what's the latest medical history I've got going on. You're all familiar with that, right? You're not asked for that information anymore, are you? Don't we wish? Okay, I had a doctor's appointment this morning, filled out the same form. Yes, it's the same as it was when I was in here last week. Anyway, the point being that the way the internet was designed, it could not, by its fundamental design, provide both the flexibility and ease of use for access for controlled sharing of information between patients, healthcare providers, insurance companies as the on a need-to-know basis, and at the same time provide the security necessary to control that effectively. With blockchain technology, you can do that. And the leading providers of healthcare information technology services all over the world are working feverishly to implement blockchain technologies to help bring this about. It's going to take a few more years, just like e-commerce on the internet did not come around overnight. Now we're completely used to the idea. We feel like it's been around forever. No, not really. Early days of e-commerce, Amazon, 1995, very cool stuff. But it took a good decade for e-commerce to become widely accepted and started to be widely used. And it really hasn't been until about the last 5 to 10 years that it has been seamlessly used virtually everywhere, the way that we have seen much more recently. Why not land titles? Why not land titles? Cook County, Illinois, Chicago, is the third largest jurisdiction of land titles in the world, over 4 million land titles in Cook County. They are in the middle of a multi-year, it's probably going to end up taking them close to a decade altogether, process to take all of those land titles and convert them to the blockchain. But when they will have accomplished doing that, and these other efforts are also going on in a number of other jurisdictions in the United States and around the world, then title searches will no longer take many days or several weeks or more in some cases. They will be able to be done in a matter of minutes. Why not 3D printing design files? Why not? Oh, well, because 3D printing design files, oh my gosh, those are huge. Those are multi-gigabyte bit files. You can't put a file that large out on a blockchain. And those of you, again, who've been in Dr. French's class are probably aware of the fact that, yes, you don't want to be slowing blockchains down by putting multi-gigabit files out there on the blockchain. You don't need to. All you need to do is put the token or the key that provides access to the off-chain stored files. And to keep those files secure, we're also beginning to see tools such as file sharding use, so that files are broken up into unrecognizable individual segments that when they need to be accessed with the correct token being made available to an authorized person or entity, those files will be reassembled and can be made available. And in the case that I talked about with the airline part and then downloaded to the 3D printer, for example. Why not, in fact, something as simple as a purchase order? And this gets back to some of the core supply chain issues. And really, when we say the word supply chain, we tend, understandably, and probably correctly, to think of the many, many cases where we're talking about supply chains that include manufacturers, distributors, wholesalers, transportation carriers, retailers, and so forth. But there are counterparts in almost every industry where you have multiple types of entities operating within a given business or social ecosystem that interact with one another on a regular basis. Over the last generation, the last 30 to 40 years, we've seen a huge transition from information being exchanged in business ecosystems by pieces of paper sent through the US Postal Service or through national postal services or international postal services, and then a slight step forward with the introduction and ultimate demise over time of fax machines, to eventually this information exchange taking place primarily electronically. But it doesn't solve the information problem, because what we see in supply chains is still data being passed up and down on a stepwise basis, one step at a time, from one part of the supply chain to the next part to the next part. Now again, most of us are fully aware that supply chains are not just a single one-dimensional chain. Supply network is really a better term to use, but supply chain is the term that's been adopted over the last several decades. But the point being that the sharing of information, when you're relying on it being passed, the problem is if that passing includes an inaccuracy, or there's a delay, or some of the information simply fails to get forwarded, then everybody else in that supply chain or network that's relying on that information to be there on a timely, accurate basis has to make business decisions based on the best information that they have available to them at the time. So with every error that's introduced anywhere in the supply chain, you have a degradation of the quality of the supply chain as a whole. Now, there are certainly the global supply chain issues we're dealing with as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic certainly have numerous external reasons why our supply chains have been impacted. But a big part of the problem is simply that people don't have visibility as to what's going on. And that's something that there is a relatively simple technical solution for. Unfortunately, not something that could be implemented overnight. The difference between the way we've been sharing information, even electronically on supply chains, and what is possible with blockchain-based supply chains is that now we still have all the same players. And for those of you that understand how blockchain works, there's a tendency to say, well, blockchain's got all these different nodes. Yeah, but the underlying infrastructure of blockchain, the synchronization technology, ensures that the data in those nodes is identical, which means from a logical perspective, business management perspective, now you have all the participants in the ecosystem sharing a common data pool that crosses the entire ecosystem. As soon as anyone, anywhere in that supply chain, in that ecosystem, does anything, everybody else in the ecosystem who's authorized to know about it can know about it. So, for example, well, what would you not be authorized to know? Well, if I'm a, say, a distributor or a retailer, and I'm putting out bids to distributors or manufacturers to provide me with a particular product, I don't want my competitors to see each other's bids. Okay, that would be an example of something that you can easily design properly secured, encrypted systems so that the competitors can't see each other's bids. But everybody can see when a shipment has taken place. Everybody can see when a public request for bid has been issued by a particular vendor or, particular retailer or distributor, as the case might be. So the point is that rather than having to rely on 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 one-to-one exchanges of information, any one of which, if it's interfered with or doesn't come through perfectly, degrades everything else that follows, now you are sharing a common data pool of timely, accurate information. And if there's any inaccuracies in that information, you can quickly and easily determine what was the source of that inaccuracy in order to correct it and hopefully prevent it from happening going forward. Now, I mentioned this earlier, one of the important artifacts that you can have on a blockchain is a smart contract. And a smart contract is simply a computer program that can run on a blockchain. But as with the specificity of a traditional paper contract, it can specify terms and conditions under which certain activities will take place. So, for example, if I have decided that I want to buy 500 widgets at $1 a piece from this nice lady sitting right here, we can engage in a contract that confirms that. And the contract says, on receipt of 500 widgets in good condition, I need to pay her $500. That's a very simple example, but that's an example of what many purchase orders are like, for example. Now, the difference is that provides a legal basis for us, but it's still up to us to actually execute that. In other words, for us, it's not enough. I mean, we've all heard of cases where people got the stuff and then didn't pay for it. And consequently, what the smart contract can do, it can take custody over assets on the blockchain and track what has happened to date in terms of transactions or events. And then, based on the terms and conditions of that smart contract, respond to incoming events. So, for example, as part of the initiation of the smart contract, I can say, I'm setting aside $500 in escrow in that blockchain-based smart contract pending my expectation of successful completion of the transaction. So that as soon as I confirm that, yes, I got them in, did my QA inspection, they're in good shape, received the order as placed, automatically the funds are transferred back to the supplier. No invoice needs to be sent. No check needs to be done. Tremendous reduction in paperwork and administrative costs for both of us. Timing of payments. Now we might say, well, what if our standard terms are 30 days? Why do we have standard terms of 30 days in business? Because back in the 19th century, if you were going to send by mail an order for 500 widgets to be delivered from a supplier 200 miles away, by the time they had those delivered to you via carriage and somebody rode back on horseback with a payment for it, 30 days would elapse. And so we've got to allow time for people to come back with their bag of gold coins. We don't really need to do that anymore. Now it's basically a way that customers can use their suppliers as a source of financing. And of course, very frequently, it's very large companies that are using their very small suppliers as a source of cheap financing. Well, it's not that cheap, of course, because the suppliers aren't that stupid. So they say, well, we can't charge these people interest for the fact that they're not going to pay us for 30 days for the products that we sent them. So what we're going to do instead is we're just going to raise the prices a little higher. And it ends up costing them more money anyway. So it's an inefficiency in the economics. So we have the opportunity that why not pay immediately, and if you need to borrow money, go to a bank. Or some of the other options that are going to become available that we'll talk about in a few minutes. Anyway, smart contracts are one of the very important attributes and artifacts can be stored. So the impact is that with our current or traditional environment, you've got constant between suppliers and customers, constant reconciliation. What's been ordered? What's been shipped? Imagine what it must be like if you're a company like Walmart or Costco and you're dealing with a company like Procter & Gamble. You've got literally tens of thousands of orders and shipping notices and invoices and payments taking place every single day. All of these are reconciled on both ends. Is it because the people at Procter & Gamble think that the people at Walmart are out to intentionally steal from them? No. But it's because they don't feel confident that they can trust their financial livelihood to whether the systems at their trading partner are properly designed to protect them as well as to protect the trading partner. So everybody goes through this complex reconciliation process, approval process at every stage of the transactions. And in blockchain-enabled environment, everything's recorded immediately. Everybody can immediately see it. You eliminate the settlement risk. We've got clauses that can be automatically executed in a smart contract. And you've got timing that is much more quick and agile, eliminating many of the sources of delays in supply chains of all different types. But delays are not the only issue. When there's a problem with quality of a product, tracking that down can be a real problem. Now, 2 years ago, in the fall of 2019, and in the aftermath since then of COVID, this seems like relatively small potatoes. But some of you may recall that in the fall of 2019, all the romaine lettuce in the United States had to be taken off all the grocery store shelves for several weeks. Why was that? It was because it was determined that there was E. coli contamination of some romaine lettuce. And the problem was, which romaine lettuce? Where did it come from? What was the source of the contamination? Where did the contaminated lettuce? Was it because all the lettuce was contaminated? No. Not even 1% of it was contaminated. They didn't know which 1%. So if you're running a store like Walmart, for example, or any of the big grocery store chains, well, you've got two different options. You can say, Well, man, that's millions of dollars worth of romaine we'd be throwing away. Most of it's fine. Oh, let's just roll the dice. How many people are going to die after all? Well, fortunately, cooler heads prevailed and said, no, I think the good idea is we just better pull it all off until we know what the source of the problem was. And in the case of Walmart, they'd actually been studying this problem for a while. They hadn't yet been able to implement the solution, although they have subsequently done so. But they determined that in order to track romaine back to its source, from where, whatever part of the world it might be coming from, domestic or international, to try to figure out where did the contaminated romaine lettuce come from, what was the particular farm or farms that were the source, and then track back the other way to say what were all the stores that had that romaine lettuce in it. And let's assume that if you know romaine lettuce from the contaminated source came to a particular store, then you would want to throw away all the romaine lettuce in that store. We're not going to worry about whether the people in the produce department made a difference between which lettuce came from which location. But if you know that none of the contaminated lettuce from that source that was contaminated showed up at any particular store, then why throw away any of the lettuce? You don't have any reason to suspect there's anything wrong with the lettuce at that store. You probably could have saved 90% of the lettuce. The problem was it took a week, way too long, to track that down, get it off the shelves now, and then once we eventually track it down, we'll figure it out, eliminate that source or solve the problem at that source, verify it's working correctly, then we can get romaine lettuce back on the source. They were in the early stages of testing, and they said, well, let's see, with a blockchain-based shared data pool, how long it takes to track the same information back to the source, and then from the source forward to the stores. And the difference was that instead of nearly a week, it took 2 seconds. Which means, again, you'd immediately be able to make those decisions. Okay, in these 10% of our stores that do have some romaine lettuce from the contaminated source, throw it all out. Everybody else, you're fine. There's no more reason to suspect there's anything wrong with your romaine lettuce than with any other product. And so we can move ahead. Now, this ability to track provenance in blockchain is also coming into play in any number of areas, ranging from ensuring that diamonds, for example, are referred to as blood diamonds. They're not coming from sources like sources in Africa, where in some cases you've got warlords that are using slave labor to do mining, for example, of diamonds. And we see the same thing with other minerals, for example, including minerals like cobalt and others that are used in electronics, where it's very important for sustainability purposes and for global equality purposes to ensure that the sources are reliable on the up and up. The pharmaceutical cold chain, here's an excellent example. And now we all know, of course, with the transportation of vaccines for COVID, that they have to be kept at very low temperatures, especially the Pfizer vaccine has to be kept at 90 below zero or something like that, I think. I don't remember the exact, far beyond what an average refrigerated capability is. And yet one of the problems that's often been the case is you get some illicit truckers or maybe individual truckers that are hire out their driving services and their truck. Oh yeah, I have a refrigerated truck and I'll do a bid for you for this much. And they'll say, well, I don't know how the guy can do it that cheap, but okay, great, we'll take the business. We need a refrigerated truck. He's gonna charge half what anybody else is charging. And he pulls up to the dock to pick up the stuff and boy, it's all refrigerated right down to 32 degrees if, say, carrying meat or something like that, you know, right down to the temperature it's supposed to be. Let's load that meat in there. Hour after he pulls away and gets out in the interstate, all right, we're not gonna waste any more money on fuel running the refrigerator for the next 3 days while we're driving across country. We'll let it heat up to whatever the ambient temperature might happen to be, even if it's the middle of the summer. We'll drive for 3 days, save ourselves several hundred dollars worth of fuel, pass some of that back in a reduced fee to the shipper, and then 2 hours before we get in, turn it back on, we pull in. Oh, it's a nice ice-cold refrigerator truck again, and they don't know that it's gone up and down. Well, now what they're doing is they've got Internet of Things sensors embedded in the pallets or in the packaging of those particular products that need to be refrigerated that are communicating on a regular basis, every 15 minutes or even more often in some cases, to a blockchain-based record that cannot be altered to confirm that, yes, that temperature was maintained at every point during the entire journey. And as a result of that, we can rely on the fact that these vaccines or this meat or what have you has traveled appropriately through the supply chain. Now, another artifact that we can put on blockchains is self-sovereign digital identity. Very important. This is about information that identifies traditional stuff that we would think of, name, address, date of birth, telephone number, and so forth. Also, governmental and third-party issued documents like passports or driver's license or national ID cards, as the case might be. Regulatory information that includes information like, yes, this person is a licensed truck driver, or this person is a licensed healthcare provider of some particular type, or has passed a particular certification of any kind that might be relevant for them to be able to share with business partners or regulatory agencies or prospective customers or what have you, but also with biometric information about that person, facial scan, fingerprints, voice prints, retinal scans, what have you, so that you can tie that data permanently and immutably back to a specific physical individual person. So you essentially eliminate the possibility of identity theft, because somebody's got to be able to have multiple biometric forms. You know, and we can get into all kinds of, you know, 007 stuff. Well, we're going to kill the person and cut their thumbs off so we can do their fingerprints. Well, fine, but what if you got a voice print in there? You know the old saying, dead people don't talk. Well, yes, that may be true, but it also means you can't use them to validate records then if it's based on their voice print. So the point being that, again, does it make it totally theoretically impossible to do identity theft? Of course not. But it makes it so vastly harder that I think we will look back at identity theft as in another decade as a problem we are glad we've got behind us finally. And this has huge implications in a wide variety of areas. One of the most interesting of which is voting. Over the course of the last year, we have seen a number of states pass laws making it dramatically more difficult for people to vote. Much more difficult for some people to vote than for other people to vote. Under the theoretical idea that this is protecting us against voter fraud, which for the most part has not been identified, nevertheless, we all agree we don't want fraudulent voting to take place. Now, one of the things that we're starting to see is the combination of self-sovereign identities used as an enabler for online blockchain-based voting. Let's take a look at this short video that describes how this works.
The time has come to bring voting into the 21st century. Let's be honest, no one likes searching for their polling place, waiting in long lines when they arrive, and when the ballots are cast, can we even be sure they get counted correctly? We can do better. And at Follow My Vote, we've figured out just how to do it. We threw out all preconceived notions about the way voting is done today and imagined how it should be done tomorrow. It was immediately clear that an honest election needs to be verified from end to end, so there was no choice but to bring it online. Leveraging blockchain technology in combination with elliptic curve cryptography, we've broken open the ballot box to allow everyone to count the votes, all without compromising privacy or security. Instead of waiting in line, imagine voting from the comfort of your own home on your own device, and even following your vote into the ballot box to confirm that it was cast as intended and counted as cast. online voting. You want it? You got it. Finally, online voting. Follow my vote. Pass it on.
Now, Follow My Vote is just one company working on blockchain-based voting. There's a company called Votes running a blockchain for the West Virginia military personnel and travelers. The Illinois Blockchain Initiative is using blockchain to secure voter registration information, and every voter can see precisely how their vote is counted. As they mentioned, losing candidates can check the totals themselves and confirm immediately, without knowing how any specific individual voted, that every vote was counted correctly. Recounts would be unnecessary. Totals would be immediately available on the closing of the polls. And this could support any method of voting. The voting wouldn't have to take place online. Many people would choose to do that. It would make it easy for everyone to vote without having to worry about where is my polling place and what time do I have to vote. In fact, in the country of Estonia, 99% of people vote online. And if they get more information during the voting period, which typically runs for a few weeks, like we have for early voting now, if they get new information and say, oh my gosh, I didn't know that about that person that I voted for, they can go ahead and cast another ballot, which immediately cancels out their old ballot. They can keep casting new ballots, replacing the old ones, as many times as they want, right up to the moment that the final cutoff takes place, and whatever their final vote is, whether they voted once, twice, or multiple times, that's the one that will be counted at that cutoff time. It's going to be very interesting as this technology emerges to see how many of the people who are claiming that the reason for making it more difficult to vote is to protect against fraudulent votes, when you have something that will do so much better of a job to protect against fraudulent votes and also makes it easier for people to vote. I think you're going to get a lot of politicians doing backflips trying to justify their positions in that particular case. It's going to be interesting to see. Now, over the centuries, money has been changing a lot. Who likes money? Okay, I mean, what's wrong with money? Nothing wrong. We didn't really used to have money per se. I mean, for millennia, all you had was barter. You know, I'll trade you my cow for a bunch of wheat. Okay, great. Then people finally said, you know, something like gold, you know, that seems to be rare. Let's use that as a means of exchange. Let's agree that, you know, a gold bar is worth the same as a cow or whatever. And then the metal coins came along, certainly by the time of the Greeks and the Romans, we had that. Finally, printing capabilities had become sophisticated enough by the late 18th and early 19th century, we could have paper money that people would begin to be reliable about. Plastic cards came along. I can remember when I was a teenager, my father saying to me, I don't know what everybody's so excited about this credit card idea for. He said, a man pays his bills in cash or with a check drawn on a good strong bank. Of course, 10 years later, he was very excited when he got his first Diners Club card. Okay, and money has actually been represented electronically for decades now, to the point where now 88% of the money in the world is ones and zeros in computer systems. Only 12% of the money in the world is actually represented by physical cash and coins. But the difference is that the electronic money that's existed up until very recently has all been under the control of anywhere from individual banks to central banks, centralized systems managing and controlling it. It's certainly vastly more efficient than what we had before, but still has a lot of limitations and shortcomings. And then with Bitcoin and subsequently other cryptocurrencies, we've got yet another form of money out here. Now, Warren Buffett said a few years ago, I can say almost with certainty that cryptocurrencies will come to a bad end. And we've already seen earlier in this presentation that when experts like Warren Buffett make statements like this, they're always right, right? Well, maybe not. So, what we're seeing really in financial services is a convergence of technologies. Everything from big data and analytics, artificial intelligence, robotic process automation, cloud computing, even Internet of Things. But distributed ledger and blockchain technologies are really driving a lot of the most progressive thinking in the field. And what we're seeing is that decentralized finance, leveraging blockchain capabilities, is really reinventing the financial supply chain. Whereas traditionally, if I wanted to send money to you, or I wanted to pay a retailer for a purchase, for example, the information would have to go through my bank, through a payment processor, to the receiver's bank, and then to the receiver. So that the receiver ends up with the money in their bank account. Even if we do something, for example, like a Venmo app, it's still the same thing. If I want to send you $5 for paying for my Starbucks via Venmo, well, it's going to come out of my bank account. Venmo's going to send a record. It's going to end up in your bank account, being deposited in your bank account. But with decentralized finance, I've got my money in digital form as cryptocurrency in a wallet. Through blockchain-based settlement, I can send it directly to the receiver's wallet. No third-party intermediary required. And that's just the start. Decentralized finance is really a movement leveraging cryptography, blockchain, and smart contracts to be able to be open to everyone, and it doesn't require trust. If I want to make a Bitcoin, pay in Bitcoin, move from my wallet to your wallet, once it's confirmed, I don't have to trust that I'm going to get paid by you, that there's a gap or a time where I have to worry about it. Is it going to settle up properly? Are we going to come out even on this transaction? And decentralized finance is being used for a number of different applications. Lending and borrowing, for example. Compound has a algorithmic autonomous interest rate protocol that's got hundreds of millions of dollars locked into it already. People provide assets in the forms of various different cryptocurrencies like Ether, Tether, and others. And that is used as collateral that can earn interest, but also be used to borrow to use other assets. So if you decide, you know what, I've got a certain amount of my resources tied up in Ether, but I think that some other cryptocurrency, or even some other non-crypto, non-financial investment, is going to be better for me, I'll borrow against that Ether, invest at a rate that I believe is going to be higher, just as I would if I borrowed money to start a business from a bank, invest at a rate that is going to give me a return that's higher than what that interest rate borrowing cost is going to be. And only it is all done automatically. We're also seeing the emergence of what are referred to as stable coins. Now, stable coins, the idea here is that leveraging smart contracts and incentives, you can ensure that a coin stays at or very close to a value of an existing fiat currency like the US dollar, or the euro, renminbi, or what have you. Now, an example of an algorithmic stable coin is DAI, but there are also non-algorithmic stable coins like Tether and USD Coin and PAX, and the distinction with those is that those companies are actually holding actual dollars or euros as a guarantee against the value of the coin. In the case of DAI, the smart contract and incentive structure algorithms that underlie it ensure that it's not going to vary far. It might go plus or minus 1%, typically not that high, but as soon as it does, the people will want to hedge against that difference and quickly bring the value very back close to that. Stable coins have another number of important applications. But again, these are just a couple of examples. And Compound and Aave are a couple of companies that are offering non-algorithmic stable coins. But these are just a few examples of applications of decentralized finance. And again, we don't have time this evening to get into all the different capabilities. But basically, everything that's done in finance today, including decentralized exchanges, derivatives, margin trading, insurance, there are decentralized versions of those things being developed. If I can make an analogy for you, it's like 25 years ago, I was doing a presentation to a group of executives on this new technology called the internet. And I said, now let me demonstrate one example of what I think we're going to be seeing on the internet in the future. So I called up, I said, now this is this new website, it's just been up less than a year now. And who knows whether they'll ever make anything out of themselves, we'll see. They call themselves Amazon.com. And I went on to Amazon, and I ordered a copy of my own book and had it shipped to my office, which was, you know, and if you think about it, kind of a silly thing to do, because I was paying full retail price, Amazon's discounted price, for which they were paying me even less, so that was my first contribution to Jeff Bezos's multi-billions. But the point was, it illustrated, you know, here's how this can work in the future. And one of the executives in the audience says, well, Jack, that's a very interesting demonstration, but what has this got to do with us? We don't sell books. They couldn't picture that the internet, well, you mean you could use it for something other than books too? Yeah. So the same thing, it's kind of hard to picture. Everything we do in finance today could end up with counterparts with decentralized finance? Well, yes, exactly. Just as everything we were doing without the internet 25 or 30 years ago is internet enabled today, or virtually everything, with a few rare exceptions. And we're going to see much the same thing taking place. So the distinctions are between decentralized finance and traditional centralized finance is decentralized finance is permissionless. It does not require KYC, know your customer. It's open to anyone, whereas centralized finance is closed. Now, most bankers and a lot of business people would say, well, who would want to have a system like that? Well, maybe the 2 billion people in the world who don't have bank accounts right now, including tens of millions of people in the United States who don't have bank accounts, might be thinking that a system that doesn't require them to have a bank account would be a good thing to be able to have. It doesn't necessarily mean it's so that they can rip people off. They just want to have advantages of being able to deal with these systems. They're also censorship resistant, as opposed to systems that can be censored. It's one of the reasons why the government of China is trying to crack down on blockchain-based systems, because they want to be able to control what's going on. They're cheaper because you don't have to pay intermediaries for many of these transactions because they're built on the blockchain instead of old foundations. So at the same time, especially when you think not of the four giant banks or the next 20 huge multi-hundred billion dollar asset under management banks, but you get down to the hundreds, thousands really still, of other banks around the United States and around the world, generally referred to as community banks, small and mid-sized banks. They still have a value proposition that's important, your local bank. One of the reasons they exist is you have a banker that knows you personally, understands your business. You want to actually be able to secure your savings, not having to put a vault in your own house. You don't want to have to worry about using cash to make payments. You don't want to worry about what happens if I get defrauded and ripped off. Are you going to stand behind that? So it's very reassuring when we buy things with a credit card to know if we really do get ripped off, we can go back to the credit card company and say, hey, here's what happened, and I want to, you know, deny this. And much of the time, if it's a legitimate request, we're going to get credited it back, even though that may cost the credit card company some money. Those things aren't going to go away. What people are really looking at, it's not a choice between a traditional, non-digital, non-decentralized banking system, such as we've had up until the last decade, and a totally bank-free, decentralized financial system. What we're going to be seeing and what customers, I think, want and need for banks is both the personalized relationships and convenience of that banks offer, combined with the speed and security and low cost and convenience that blockchain-enabled decentralized financial systems offer. I think we will see both of them coming together. Now, the banking industry will change a lot. How exactly it changes is a little hard to see right now. But think how much the music industry has changed in the last 20 years. okay? It's not that long ago that if you wanted to listen to a new song, you went to the record store and you bought it on a CD. Or if you're as old as I am, you bought it on a vinyl LP record. And that was produced by a producer and sent to a physical printer of the records, and that went to a distributor, and that went to a store. Now who does that? We don't even download MP3s anymore. We just stream what we want to hear. Okay? The market has changed tremendously, but it doesn't mean people have stopped making music, and it doesn't mean there aren't producers out there who are making money from making music. It's just a very different industry from what it was. How will banking and financial industry change? In some respects, I think it may change as much, but in ways that are unique to that particular industry. Now, some other industries will be different. When you think about healthcare, when you think about manufacturing of consumer products and so forth, yes, those industries will also be changing a lot. Their business processes will evolve tremendously. But at some point, somehow, you're still going to have to produce some physical products. Maybe they'll be 3D printed locally rather than produced in massive factories and shipped all over the world. That'll save a lot of problems with the supply chain. But the fundamental principles will still be the same in many cases. We're still going to have to grow food. We're still going to want to have local shops and stores for a variety of things. But behind the scenes, we're going to see tremendous changes. Now, we're seeing a move toward investments in and use of crypto. Because of the fact that Bitcoin is difficult and expensive to engage in the transactions, I think we may see some changes with the Bitcoin Lightning Network and the new Taproot changes to Bitcoin that make it a little more amenable to using Bitcoin as a means of exchange. But I think for the foreseeable future, it's primarily going to be used more as a store of value. In many cases, like gold has traditionally been used as a hedge against volatility in the economy as a whole. And we do tend to see that. In general, like with gold, when there are economic and political problems, the price of Bitcoin goes up. Look at what happened with Bitcoin between the early days when it was dropping in early 2020, and then as the pandemic really started kicking in, all of a sudden Bitcoin started going back up. People were fleeing to it, much the same has happened with gold historically over the years too. But what we see is that consumers, institutions, governmental organizations of all types are looking into how can we use this new tool of decentralized finance, cryptocurrency, to add value, and for the for-profit organizations to make more money. Well, you make more money by serving customers more cost-effectively, and everybody benefits if you can do that right. Well, right now, well, at least as of Sunday, these were the top 10 cryptocurrencies, and of course, Bitcoin is still the big gorilla in the marketplace, followed not particularly closely, but by a strong second by Ethereum, and then a number of the others. Binance Coin, because Binance is a decentralized exchange, and the coin is used to facilitate transactions on that exchange, that's a value for it. Tether is the largest in market value, at least, of the stable coins. Solana is a coin used for a type of blockchain platform, as is Polkadot, as is Cardano, as really is XRP, highly specialized. And all of those are being recognized for the value that those platforms might offer. I don't think we're going to see one single platform ever become the one and only dominant platform, whether it's Bitcoin, Ethereum, or any of the other ones like Solana and Cardano that are on the rise. I think we'll see applications done on many of these platforms, and we'll see a tremendous effort over the next several years to integrate cross-blockchain platforms so that people, organizations, ecosystems that have blockchain implementations on one platform will easily be able to design those in such a way that they can interact with other blockchain implementations. Some of you may be too young to recall this, but in the early 90s, people often referred to the internets. The reason being that there were numerous implementations of IP technology that tied together groups that didn't work very well with others. So you could exchange information with a bunch of people, but not everybody else. Well, by the time we were very into the late 90s or very far into this century, most of that issue had been resolved, and anybody doing anything on the internet could interact with anybody else doing anything else on the internet, unless there was some explicit reason why that was blocked for security purposes or what have you. We'll see the same thing going on with blockchain, in my opinion. Now, part of the reason I spend so much time on blockchain is because we've been hearing about AI since many of you were born, or those of us that were born a long, long time ago, since we're certainly very young. These other technologies are not entirely new, but blockchain has emerged almost completely within the last dozen years now. And in terms of widespread understanding and acceptance, really only within the last 3 to 5 years at most. But a second reason is because blockchain provides a critical role in digital transformation. I have to say, I am still appalled at how many organizations for marketing purposes describe digital transformation as simply being, we can design you a cooler website and that'll digitally transform your business. No, that will not digitally transform your business. It may be a more effective way of marketing your product or service, but that's not changing the way your company works or your organization works if it's a not-for-profit organization or a governmental entity or what have you. Digital transformation is about thinking much more broadly than that. The challenge is most emerging technologies are point solutions. Tools like 3D printing, augmented and virtual reality, Internet of Things, even artificial intelligence, they apply at a specific organizational point or even at a specific physical location. But blockchain is different because blockchain provides the decentralized infrastructural glue that ties all of those points together. It enables digital transformation, not just of specific individual processes, but of entire organizations and even more broadly, entire business or social ecosystems, like the financial ecosystem, for example. Now, I do want to come back around to touch on one more set of emerging technologies that is also going to be impacting us tremendously over the remainder of this decade. I showed you a quick clip out of the HoloPresence technology presentation that I did in Las Vegas just 2 weeks ago. But I also want to share with you a little bit more of that to give you some idea of some of the things that HoloPresence enables. For example, and it's important to understand that HoloPresence, the idea of 3D virtual imaging is not a new one. In some concepts, it goes back over a century. Many of us are much more familiar with an application that was illustrated a little over 40 years ago, 44 years ago to be specific. But in another sense, it was something that happened a long time ago.
Now, let's see if we can't figure out what you are, my little friend, and where you come from.
I saw part of the message.
I seem to have found it.
General Kenobi, years ago you served my father in the Clone Wars. Now he begs you to help him in his struggle against the Empire. I regret that I am unable to present my father's request to you in person, but my ship has fallen under attack, and I'm afraid my mission to bring you to Alderaan has failed. I have placed information vital to the survival of the rebellion into the memory systems of this R2 unit. My father will know how to retrieve it. You must see this droid safely delivered to him on Alderaan. This is our most desperate hour. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
Well, of course, at the time, that was just science fiction. Now we're seeing such things as remote performances.
Hey, little girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone now? Got a bad desire. Oh, 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 I'm on fire.
And I should describe, for those of you that haven't seen this before, what we had on that screen in Las Vegas, what you just saw there, although you can't see it very well because your mind quickly filters it out, it was about an 8-foot-high, 4-foot-wide screen. And to everybody in the audience, it looked like you were looking through a window at a person standing there in three dimensions, performing, talking, turning, absolutely. And another example of this, here's an example of an application that shows multiple participants in a panel discussion from various cities. Now, it's in German, so if your German isn't good, well, don't worry about it. I think you'll get the point.
Ist ein absoluter Top-Club aus Spanien. Hallo Diego Simeone.
Ah, buenas tardes a todos.
Der dritte Verein, der am Audi Cup teilnehmen wird, ist ein absoluter Top-Club in England. Hallo Jürgen Klopp, viele Grüße nach Anfield, nach Liverpool.
Hallo, servus nach München.
Hallo meine Herren, fangen wir.
Now, here's another example. Here's a speaker that, instead of using PowerPoint, like we've got here tonight, and so many of us have seen so many times, is using holographically projected three-dimensional animations.
One thing that's important to understand is that technology isn't changing the basic principles of investing. It just allows us to execute them better. One analogy that I like to use is Michelangelo, perhaps the greatest artist ever. Imagine if he were alive today and had access to modern technologies. In his case, things like X-rays and CAD drawings and laser measurement tools. He could find weak spots in his block of marble before he started carving, or he could use lasers and other power tools to sculpt more quickly. I believe that were he alive today with the access to these types of technologies, that Michelangelo would create something even more beautiful than David, or at the very least, create David more quickly. Now, if you gave me that same block of marble and those tools, you would get a hacked up piece of marble.
And here we actually have an interview that I did during that event.
Well, I was simply beaming in from backstage, a guest who was beaming in from 2,000 miles away in Toronto, where the corporate headquarters of Arc Media takes place. And I'd like you to meet Larry O'Reilly, CEO of Arc Media. Larry? Well, hello again, Larry.
Morning,
how are you doing?
How are we doing?
Great, great. It's good to see you again.
Thank you, you too.
Okay. Well, off to your left are our people in the audience. And I wanted to tell you, I've got a few questions. Love to get a little more background on all of this. And then if you don't mind, we'd like to open up the questions to the audience too. So
sure.
The first question is that, tell us a little bit about the background of Arc Media and how this technology came to be developed. I mean, I understand you joined the company as CEO just a few years ago. But what was it about Arc Media and the technology that excited you and wanted you to become part of this?
Sure. In the earlier days of Arc Media, the technology was used for large-scale events with people like Tony Robbins, Gary Vaynerchuk, Stephen Hawking, Deepak Chopra, where they were actually doing their presentations that they normally would be doing to arena-sized type audiences. A few years ago, I was introduced to the technology through somebody who I worked with from my IMAX days, and I was in an office building in downtown Toronto, and they beamed in a guy live from Los Angeles, and we were having this conversation, much like you and I are right now, where I had the feeling the person was right there in the room with me, and I thought, wow, this should be able to solve all kinds of business issues and problems and challenges. And we could scale well beyond just arena-sized shows. I'll leave out of here now, Jack. See you later.
Thank you.
Now, I edited out about 20 minutes worth of interaction that we actually had with Larry, including questions in the audience. He could see the audience and respond to their questions just as they could see him. And again, like I said, it gives you the feeling that you're actually physically there with that same person. I remember the first time I saw, because I referred to having met him before. Actually, we've never been in the same physical room before. But when they did a demonstration of the technology for me and we recorded a promotional video clip for this particular event back last spring at their studio in New York, he beamed in from Toronto. And one of the things that struck me was I was looking at the gleam of the polish on his shoes. And I could have sworn that he was physically right there in the room. I could see it so clearly. So it was huge leap forward from being in a Zoom meeting, even if you project the Zoom up on a full-size screen, because you really feel like you're there interacting with people in person. But it's just a part of what's going on. Holopresence has great advantages, especially compared with 2D virtual technologies, because you've got nonverbal body language, which means you've got a higher level of engagements, whether it's with individuals or with a broader audience as a whole, better comprehension. It's a really much more interactive process. Now, a lot of people have heard this term metaverse in the last couple of weeks. This is not something that Mark Zuckerberg made up. Okay, the term was actually coined by Neal Stephenson in his dystopian science fiction novel Snow Crash back in 1992. And the concept of virtual reality, of course, we've seen versions of this in things like the Matrix, for example. I don't think we're going to end up quite where the Matrix takes us, but we're going to see some steps in this direction. And one of the things I'd like to share with you is the best short explanatory video of what are some of the ideas behind what Zuckerberg calls the metaverse.
Metaverse is the hot new buzzword in tech. To understand it, let's talk about how we engage with people on the internet. We go to different websites, such as social media platform or messaging applications, communicate with other users via text, share multimedia, and make video calls. Metaverse aims to take this experience a notch higher. The idea is to create new online spaces in which people's interactions can be more multidimensional, where users are able to immerse themselves in digital content rather than simply viewing it. So, metaverse basically refers to digital spaces which are made more lifelike by the use of virtual reality or augmented reality. In other words, it's an online world where people can use different devices to move and communicate in a virtual environment. Some people even use the word metaverse to describe gaming worlds in which users have a character that can walk around and interact with other players. Science fiction is another example. Many sci-fi films are set in fully fledged metaverses, meaning they are set in alternative digital worlds which are indistinguishable from the real physical world. Until now, this was the stuff of fiction, but the concept is catching on. The who's who of the tech world are now seeing a virtual reality universe as the future of the internet. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg has said that the company will try to transition from being a social media company to a metaverse company in the next 5 years or so. The tech giant has even announced plans to create 10,000 jobs in the European Union over the next 5 years to help build the so-called metaverse. Microsoft also intends to converge the digital and physical worlds. The popular children's game Roblox describes itself as a metaverse company. Epic Games' Fortnite is also considered to be a part of the metaverse. Musicians can do virtual concerts within these platforms. For example, in September, millions of people watched the singer Ariana Grande virtually perform in Fortnite. Baby, The world's biggest fashion companies have also experimented with making virtual clothing, which people's avatars can wear in metaverse environments. The potential of this emerging technology is limitless. The accelerated interest in the metaverse can be seen as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, as more people have started working and going to school remotely. There has been an increase in demand for ways to make online interactions more lifelike. Fans of the metaverse now see it as the next stage in the development of the internet.
So imagine that with augmented reality technology at some point in the near future, somebody may be physically in a given location, but somebody who is virtually in the same location and able to interact with them may see them dressed in whatever fashion attire they particularly would like to appear to be dressed in, where you have AI capabilities changing their appearance of their clothing or maybe even their makeup or hairstyle, while it's still the same basic underlying person who is moving around and interacting. And you could attend a conference where half the people at the conference are there in person, live, physically, and the other half of the people in the conference are 3D digital avatars, and at some point, very difficult to discern unless you get up to the point of physically interacting with them, whether they're actually there physically or just projecting an image. And to other people who are interacting in the conference remotely or virtually, the image they may project to those people may look different in some way because, again, what they're wearing, how their makeup is made, and so forth. A lot of other interesting issues. A concert that took place, for example, in just about 2 years ago this month, I believe, in Italy. Part of the problem was half the group that was performing the song was back in Berlin. Let's take a look at it from the perspective of the people who were live in the audience in Italy.
Papers in the roadside tell of suffering and greed. Here today, forgot tomorrow. Oh, here besides the news of holy war and holy need, our just a little sorrow talk. Thank you.
Now, one of the keys to what makes this work is they're using 5G technology for communication. 5G is not just way faster than 4G. The latency time is reduced dramatically from tenths of a second to thousandths of a second, which means you can synchronize things perfectly. It's not just singers singing in tune and in time with one another, even though they're hundreds and hundreds of miles apart. But think about the possibilities for remote robotic surgery. Right now, for many procedures, robotic surgery is a miracle. Because the surgeon sits in one room that's hardwired to the actual surgical robot that's performing a particular procedure and is able to control with a degree of precision that no human can on their own exactly where and what is cut. But it's because they're hardwired that they can do that. If they were to try to do that from across the country or around the world right now, with the delays that we're used to if we're just talking to each other, they wouldn't know how far that scalpel has moved before they're starting to bring it back the other direction. Not a good thing if you're doing surgery on people, okay? But if you reduce the delay, the latency from tenths of a second down to thousandths of a second, it can still be done. So again, we'll see remote robotic surgeries taking place within a few years. Now here's another interesting example of this. Augmented reality restoration here in Seoul. And they'll explain one of the four city gates of Seoul that were torn down in the early 20th century, a little over 100 years ago. Three of them were reconstructed physically. The fourth couldn't be because it was at such a major intersection that they would have had to tear out huge streets and buildings and everything. They couldn't do it, so they reconstructed it digitally.
Finally, 104 years after its demolition, the government of Seoul City and the Cultural Heritage Administration recently restored the gate digitally. Reference was made to the remaining photos of the gate in historical materials, as well as Changimun Gate and Hwasamun Gate in the Suwon Hwasong Fortress, which were built during the same period as Donimun. The historic relic can be viewed in its original form on a 55-inch large screen.
서대문 같은 경우에는 그게 없어서 잘 모를 텐데 이렇게 눈으로 직접 볼 수 있게 돼서 교육에도 효과가 있을 거라고 생각합니다.
The gate can also be seen on smartphones using a special app when users are in the area.
잊혀진 역사를 우리가 직접 보고 또 체험할 수 있게 하는 스마트 관광의 새로운 콘텐츠라고 생각합니다.
So with the mobile device using augmented reality, you can walk in the area and you can look at that mobile device and you can see that original gate superimposed over the actual buildings that are there today. Now, in the near future, as we have augmented reality and virtual reality glasses that are as easy to wear as a pair of glasses or a pair of sunglasses, people will be able to see everything with augmented reality capabilities like that. And this is where capabilities that are being developed now, like the Venice time machine, come into play. As it happens, the people in Venice have been crazy about keeping records of everything for literally over 1,000 years. Every building that was built, including the designs of the buildings, the sale and exchange of properties and so forth. So in the Rialto, oldest area of Venice, all the way back to the year 950 now, they've been able to reproduce what each individual building was built at what point in time. Here you can see as it emerges forward, and at the Arno River, and finally, as they get up to the 1200s, they say, you know, it would be a good idea to put a bridge across the river and develop the property on the other side of it too. And they finally did, and they put across a bridge that was called in Italian the Old Bridge, but of course is now much better known by anybody who has ever been to Florence as the Ponte Vecchio. And here you can watch this being developed. But what you'll be able to do with the enhanced digital capabilities that they are adding is, again, this may be 5 or 10 years down the road, but we're not talking science fiction generations in the future here, is wearing a pair of virtual reality glasses, you'll be able to walk through Venice and say, let me see what the city would have looked like if I was walking through here in the 1700s. Or the 1300s, the buildings looking like. Perhaps even the people walking by me using AI-enabled augmented reality to appear to be dressed in clothing that was typical of the time frame that I'm curious to visit virtually while I'm physically in the city walking around. And I say, wow, look at that cool 15th century dress that that lady is wearing. I would love to buy that for my girlfriend. Let me acquire it as an NFT to begin with, and if I like it, I'll send it off to a dressmaker so that she can wear it next time we're going to a costume party or Halloween or whatever the case might be. We're going to see an integration of these technologies that's quite amazing. One of my five favorite expressions of Bill Gates, and this picture was obviously taken some time ago, but it was when he said that we always overestimate the change that will occur in the next 2 years and underestimate the changes that will occur that will take place over the next 10. Don't let yourself be lulled into inaction. We'll be seeing more change in the next 10 years than we've seen in the last 100. And you guys are at a very exciting time to help drive this. Digital transformation is the key to this. It's not about force-fitting new technologies into your existing business or organization. It's about reimagining your business model, even your entire ecosystem. So the idea isn't, how can we figure out how to use technology to do exactly what we're doing today a little bit more efficiently? I mean, fine, there's nothing wrong with that. It's a lack of imagination. Understand how they can affect working processes and then use all of the available and emerging technologies to implement a new vision. Some of the biggest hurdles, and those of you that are in business today, I think will agree with these. Understanding of these technologies and the potential use cases. Explaining technologies to key decision makers. That's probably the main reason that I'm engaged so frequently by corporate executives for annual meetings and senior executive briefings and board meetings and that kind of thing is to help their key decision makers understand the impact of these emerging technologies and how they're going to change their business and what they can do to plan for it. Evaluating the costs and benefits of use cases. Uncertainty about the time needed to start reaping those benefits. Re-engineering, redesigning the business processes, as well as understanding the legal and compliance issues. Procuring the talent and expertise. All of these things are things that are very important to be done. And you need to do them in a particular order. It starts with awareness. People aren't even aware of what something like blockchain means and its potential implications, then they don't even understand why should I bother to be learning about this. But that's the next step, is education, understanding. What is this thing? How does it mean? It does not mean that your non-technical senior executives need to be technical experts in how hashing algorithms work or blockchain consensus methodologies are implemented or various different forms of AI. It does mean that they need to understand what potentially these new technologies can enable you to do in order to develop a strategy. Only after building awareness and developing understanding can you coherently develop a strategy that says, so what does this mean for our business? How do we need to rethink the way our organization works to survive and thrive in this new world we're going to be in? Then you can begin to move toward implementation with things like proofs of concept and expanding across the enterprise and even participating in changes across ecosystems as a whole, as I illustrated with the example of decentralized finance. And none of this matters unless you have a broader planning process for anticipating and managing strategic disruptions. Now, obviously, one example of strategic disruptions is pandemics, but climate change is just as big an impact on us. Geopolitical disruptions over the last few years were disrupting supply chains very significantly, even before the pandemic started doing so. And emerging technologies themselves, like blockchain and AI, are very disruptive to many organizations. Now, how do you plan for uncertainty in the long term? In the military, there's a famous saying that says the first casualty of war is the plan.
Or as the boxer Mike Tyson used to say about his opponents, everybody's got a strategy till they get hit in the mouth. The point being that if by planning you talk about traditional strategic planning, which says, oh yeah, once a year we get a few key people together and we sit down for a couple of weeks and we think about things, and what it really means is we look at next year's financial projections, we do a little tweaking around the edges, we say, okay, we've updated our strategy, we go back to business as usual until something comes along like the COVID pandemic. But with dynamic transformational planning, it's not only the old saying, which is very correct, think globally, act locally, it's also think long-term, act short-term. What it means is that you've got to have goals, first of all. Goals are how do you leverage your core competencies, your resources, your capabilities to address the changing needs of the markets, or in the case of non-profit or governmental organizations, the constituencies that you serve, while at the same time addressing current and potential strategic threats and disruptions to your business. To achieve goals, you've got to have plans. And you can have more than one plan. There's more than one way to skin a cat, as they say. You have more than one plan to accomplish any particular goal. And you're going to have multiple goals. But to give you an example, suppose one of your goals is, keep it very simple and personal, drive home from work. Now, this is assuming you're back to driving to work to begin with. And you might have two different plans. Plan A is we're going to take the expressway. Plan B is now we're going to drive on surface streets. Each plan has its advantages and disadvantages, and you might decide to switch plans. So, for example, if there's an accident on the expressway, you might say, oh, normally it's faster, but I better get off and take the surface streets because I don't want to get stuck here for 45 minutes between exits from the expressway. Now, in order to execute a plan, you need to have resources and capabilities, which means you have to achieve the goals of acquiring or mobilizing those resources and capabilities. Those are sub-goals to help you execute a plan to achieve your higher order goals. And to achieve those sub-goals, you have to execute sub-plans. And eventually you get down to individual actions that have to be taken. Now this all sounds very complex and confusing when you're trying to describe it verbally, but there is a tool called a plan goal graph. And to show you how this works, it simply says, here's your overall plan for your organization as a whole. You may have a number of goals. Have technology, have staffing, have facilities, generate revenues, high order goals, plan for strategic disruptions and so forth. For each of those goals then, you might have multiple plans. So for goal number two, here's various different plans. For goal number five, here's several different plans for accomplishing that goal. For any one of those plans now, you've got sub-goals to accomplish that sub-plan. So you can see if you map all these things out, the fact is real-world plan goal graphs, even for large organizations, will tend to be about 5 to 10 layers deep. But these plans and goals, these plan goal graphs, can be developed typically with the right team within a few days of work. The point is they have to be continually updated. And you have to apply variables to balance the relative value of your goal. Some of your goals are more important than others. Some are more significant than others. That doesn't mean you can ignore any of them. It just means some of them justify a higher level of investment, a cost in the plans to execute them. You also need to assign variables to measure the costs. What's it going to cost us to execute the plan we need, the best plan that we need to execute in order to achieve this goal, which is part of our overall business strategy? This is where you need to be able to estimate, among other things, the likelihood of the plan's success. So one of the things you need to do is think about invoking Bayesian reasoning to correctly factor in contingent probabilities. How many people are familiar with Bayesian belief networks or Bayesian reasoning? Okay, go Google it. I'm not going to get into the mathematics of how Bayesian reasoning works, but it's about contingent probabilities. And what it basically means is it's not just what is the probability that occurrence X might happen,
But it takes it to the next step that says, well, if occurrence X were to happen, then what would be the probability that occurrence Y might happen? And you can imagine that it fairly quickly becomes very complex. But the fact is that for over two centuries, people have known how to figure out the logic behind Bayesian reasoning. Bayes was a 17th century Protestant minister in England who came up with the concept, and people looked at it and said, but if it's anything other than very simple two or three contingent probabilities, you'd have to be able to do thousands of calculations in order to be able to come up with a valid answer. What use will that ever be? When will we ever be able to do thousands of calculations in any reasonable amount of time? Suddenly in the 1970s, they looked around and said, oh, we've got computers now. We can do thousands of calculations in a fraction of a second. And Bayesian reasoning becomes a much more pragmatic thing to be able to do. And with that in place, now you can be able to monitor your external environment in a dynamic way. It's important to think also about enterprise risk-adjusted impact. So what's the potential impact of external strategic disruptions? What's the likelihood of it? And then what's the severity? Now, obvious low priorities, if it's not very likely and if it happens, it's not going to be a big problem for us, we're not going to waste a lot of time on it, right? Obvious high priority, this is very likely to happen and it's going to have a hugely disruptive impact on us. This is a pretty high priority for us to be focused on, okay? That's not hard to figure out. The problem is most organizations spend way too much time looking at those things that are high likelihood but low severity. Oh, this is probably going to happen. We better spend a lot of time and effort thinking about it. Well, yeah, but if it does happen, it's not going to. For example, it's like companies that say, well, we need to analyze what happens if a competitor moves into our space. Well, duh. Competitors move into companies' business spaces all the time. So of course you have to keep track of that, but it's not a strategic priority. It's something that should be an obvious ongoing operational activity. What requires much more attention in most organizations are the things that are low likelihood but could have a huge strategic impact. Like, what if some new technology that comes along and develops a completely new way of managing finance and doing banking? If I'm a bank, I better be thinking about, is this going to completely change the way my market works in the next 10 years? So here I am focusing all this time and attention on making the way I do business as a bank currently more efficient, and none of it's going to be relevant in a decade. Maybe I better be thinking more about that. Maybe I ought to be thinking more about, well, yeah, pandemics, how often do those happen? Once or twice a century. So why spend any time worrying about it, right? Interestingly enough, I talked to a guy who a year ago last summer interviewed 100 organizations in Europe and asked them, what part of your business strategy allowed for the possibility of a pandemic and what to do if one hit us? 99 of them said, we had nothing in our strategy at all. We were starting from scratch to figure out what to do when the pandemic came out. The one exception, NATO, the military. They said, yep. When the pandemic hit, we went into our strategic plan and we threw pandemic coming switch and recalibrated all of our strategic planning for it. It all had accommodated that. Low priority, low likelihood, high severity, they were able to respond quickly to it. So monitoring is key. It's important to monitor circumstances closely. This is why people use tools like Waze to keep track of the traffic, for example. And it also is important to that organizations actively monitor for potential strategic disruptions and threats so that they can catch them at the front end, even if they're not currently happening. Now, one of, in my opinion, the biggest mistake that the previous U.S. federal government administration made in dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic happened a year and a half before the pandemic hit. It's when they took a look at the operations of the National Security Agency that were taking place in the White House, and in spring of 2018 said, we've got a whole staff of people dedicated to pandemic preparedness. This is costing millions of dollars. Why are we spending millions of dollars when there's no pandemic? Get rid of these people. Stop monitoring for a pandemic. This is a waste of time and money. So when the pandemic did hit a year and a half later, they were scrambling from scratch to try to figure out what to do, which is why the responses to it were delayed by weeks and months as a result. So the lesson is one that every organization needs to keep in mind. Strategic planning is not a once-a-year project or activity. It's something that needs to be an ongoing process. And in my opinion, any organization ought to have 1% of their people resources on a full-time basis or full-time equivalents dedicated towards strategic planning and monitoring. Because as the world changes more and more rapidly, you've got to be updating your strategic planning much more rapidly too. So in summary, businesses can think long-term, setting strategic goals, provide flexibility to shift dynamically in the short and medium term to address both anticipated and unanticipated strategic contingencies, both as opportunities as well as threats and disruptions. It's going to require huge changes in the way we think and in the ways that organizations work. But as a famed historian, Henry Steele Commager, put it so well over a century ago, change does not necessarily assure progress, but progress implacably requires change. Help become the drivers of the changes in your organizations, in your careers, in the organizations that you work for now and in the future, to help ensure that you and they not only survive but thrive in the era of tremendous change we've got before us. Thanks for listening. Now, I know we've already run over time, and I appreciate your patience and all that. And if some of you need to run, I understand perfectly, but I'm happy to stay and answer questions for as long as you would like to. Well, within reason. At some point, after a while, there's going to have to be beer involved or something like that. But if for the meantime, happy to open up for questions. So who's got the first question? Oh, come on, I can see this is not a shy crowd. We've got one over here. Yes, sir. A little louder, I'm sorry. Validity fruits?
Validity proofs, or better known as zero knowledge technology.
Oh, zero knowledge proof. I have heard of
specifically validity proofs.
I've heard of zero knowledge proofs, and I'm not exactly certain of the distinctions from a technical perspective, except that my understanding is they enable some types of blockchain-based implementations to take place more effectively while securing, and correct me if I'm wrong, while securing the privacy of the participants a little bit more effectively too. Is that accurate at a high level? Okay, all right. Well, that's probably very basic. I think it's a good thing from what I've read about it. I think it's something that's going to be important. And there are any number of evolving technical implementations around blockchain that are going to help drive a lot of the acceptance where people raise questions. Well, it can't do this or it won't do this right and so forth. And I think this is one example. And in that way, I think blockchain is really very analogous to the early days of the internet 25 or 30 years ago, when people continued to come up with new tools and approaches and techniques for solving problems that were preventing it from being widely accepted. Would you like to add anything, any comments or perspective from your point of view? Because it's an interesting point you brought up.
Which I'm sure you're familiar with that, but like that's an implementation that'll happen in the next year or so that allows people to
Right, and to tie that back to one comment I made earlier in case it went past people quickly, I talked about the fact that off-chain data can be stored and is beginning to be stored, and this will enable it very much more effectively in sharded, decentralized databases. So it's not a matter of, oh, well, if we can just figure out how to get to that one place that offline data is stored, but if it's sharded now, unless you've got the right combinations of keys or tokens that are stored on the blockchain to access the data, there's no way you can put it together. It's meaningless pieces of data.
Yeah, have you ever heard of interplanetary file systems?
Yes. Yeah, IPFS is one good example. And right here in Atlanta, Storage, STORJ, is another company that is working on implementing sharded decentralized file storage systems. Excellent point, very interesting. The technology keeps evolving. And the important thing is those of you who get actively involved in implementations of the technology will need to stay on top of and understand these emerging capabilities. Those of you who don't get actively involved may not need to understand how the underlying mathematics works or the details of how, I mean, how many people here understand exactly how it is that an automatic transmission works? How many people here can drive a car with an automatic transmission? Okay, right. How many people know the difference between an automatic transmission and a stick shift? Okay, my point being that you can appreciate the benefits or the differences between an automatic transmission and a stick shift and how you use it without necessarily knowing how to build an automatic transmission. You've got to have people, perhaps like this gentleman, who understand the technology, like sharding, to design and implement systems that do that. But that doesn't mean you have to be technical enough to design and implement the system that does it in order to appreciate what it can do for you from an organizational benefit perspective. Next question. Yes, ma'am, and back.
What do you think happened to Gerald Cotton?
What do I think happened to Gerald Cotton? I have to admit I have not a clue who Gerald Cotton is, although if you'll clarify that for me, maybe it'll come to mind.
He was the founder of the largest Canadian Bitcoin exchange.
Oh, right, the guy who died and took his codes to the grave with him. Yeah, well, there's a good example of not planning your implementations very effectively. Basically, the Bitcoin that he owned, or the cryptocurrencies that he owned, it appears at this point that they're probably lost for good. And right now they're estimating something on the order of 15 or 20% of Bitcoin is irretrievably gone for various reasons similar to this. There was a guy who bought some Bitcoin like 9 or 10 years ago when it was, you know, in single digit dollars of price, and he's got $200 million worth of Bitcoin and it's stored on a electronic wallet that he's forgotten the password to. And he's tried 7 of the 10 tries that he's got before the wallet locks itself up permanently. And he's scared to death to try the last 3, but he can't figure out what the password is, and nobody else in the world knows it. And if it goes away, his $200 million worth of Bitcoin is gone and inaccessible. So actually, part of the reason why people are looking to work with traditional financial institutions and banks and so forth for cryptocurrency purchases is exactly this type of thing. Quite frankly, if I had millions of dollars worth of Bitcoin, I would rather have a big, strong bank or financial institution of some kind saying, we will secure both the safety of it, not by necessarily storing it in a single centralized location where somebody else might hack it, but we will oversee the process as a whole. And there's tools and technologies emerging to do that. There are a number of very sad stories out there about people who've lost a lot of cryptocurrency, not because some evil person came in and hacked it and stole their keys and took away their cryptocurrency, but just because of something that seems relatively silly, like forgetting your passwords, or dying and not telling somebody else what the passwords were and doing it. So if you have cryptocurrency and it's any significant amount, make sure you've got written down somewhere in your will or where those of you who are near and dear can retrieve it at some point. So excellent, excellent point, excellent example. Other questions, comments? Yes, ma'am. Okay, the question is, how long will it take before companies like Walmart and Target are using full blockchain systems? Well, actually, they are already, in many cases, using full systems. It's just that they don't have everything they're doing in the organization. I think it will be 15 or 20 years before you see huge multi-billion dollar organizations that have essentially all of their major mission critical business processes blockchain enabled, just as we went 20 years between the mid-90s and 4 or 5 years ago before you could say large organizations had all of their systems internet enabled. And even still, parts of systems and processes of large organizations are still not yet really internet enabled, although for most large organizations, most of them are. But for example, Walmart of Canada decided to put a blockchain-based implementation in to coordinate the shipping from its half a dozen or so different distribution centers in Canada with the 60 or 70 different external carriers that they use to deliver to their hundreds of stores in Canada. And as a result of implementing this blockchain-based system, they have now been able to reduce the number of errors in their billing process for freight billing from their carriers by 98%. And the combination of eliminating the paperwork involved in resolving those errors and also being able to now more accurately schedule their carriers, because carriers charge what's called demurrage. If the carrier comes to pick something up and they're not ready to start loading the truck, or to drop something off and they're not ready to start unloading the truck, after the first 20 minutes or 30 minutes, whatever the contract says, they start charging so much per hour for the wasted time while the truck is sitting there and the driver is sitting there and nothing's happening. And that costs the company money also. So at any rate, this is now saving Walmart of Canada $10 million a year just in managing the distribution of moving the goods from their distribution centers to their stores, and just in Canada. So they're now looking at rolling the same system out in the United States, which is 50 times bigger or something like that. And so there's any number of examples out there of large companies that are implementing blockchain. It's a very common misconception that, oh yeah, well, you've got Bitcoin and so forth, but as far as blockchain itself, nobody's really using blockchain in live production business applications. Completely untrue. Now, 5 years ago, that was pretty much a true statement. Not anymore. There's any number of very significant blockchain cases going on around the world. Now, what's important is if you're working in a given organization, you want to research, well, what's happening in our industry, in our particular vertical, or in our business, or our type of government agency, and so forth, and study and research, you know, what are the examples that you can learn from, and then whether there are other things that you can do that can gain you strategic advantage. Excellent question. Other questions? Do we want to take one or two more, Aaron, before everybody gets tired and falls asleep? One more question. Who gets the last question? Come on, don't be shy. Yes, sir.
The holographic images and stuff, how much bandwidth did it take for the concert portion and for the interview that you did with you, that you were looking for you? How much actual bandwidth did that take up as well?
You know, that's an excellent question. And the concert portion, I'm not sure, because that's something I found on the internet while I was researching this field. And the information about the amount of bandwidth and the technical implementation would require a whole lot more detailed research for me to find that. But what I can try to do is find out for you, and if you'll give me your card or contact information somehow, I'll see if I can find out, or I'll get back to Aaron to see. I can check with the ARHT media people that we worked with to do the holographic transmission. What the bandwidth is. But it's not really anything really inordinate. And in talking with the guy from their team that was the project manager on site, he said, oh yeah, I had to make sure we had a high-speed internet connection, but it wasn't like anything that, oh my gosh, we've got to get something in there that we don't normally ever have to have. It was just, And it was coming in via their hardwired internet system. It wasn't coming wirelessly. But what exactly was the amount of bandwidth? Good question. But I don't my guess from just the way it commented is probably not something more than, you know, high 100 megabits, maybe a gigabyte. I don't think we're talking about terabyte bandwidths or anything like that. But I will double check and ask them. Excellent question. Leave me with a homework assignment. All right, so you see my contact information. Okay, if you have other questions and you'd like to follow up, feel free, drop me an email. You can also check out the Blockchain Executive LinkedIn group, which is about helping non-technical senior level people understand strategic applications of blockchain. So if you want to dig deep into technical implementation, like understanding the technical details behind zero knowledge proofs like the one gentleman brought up, that's not the place to look. But if you want to find out how are people using blockchain to manage their businesses more effectively, you can do that. And if you feel like, and more importantly, the senior executive team at your company feels like they need to get up to speed on these organizations, that's how I make a living, is coming in and doing those kinds of briefings. So happy to talk about that too. Thank you again. Hope you have a nice evening. And best of luck going forward from here. Thank you. Thank you, Aaron.
All right, so I know the... Y'all hear me? Okay. The IS Club wants to make a presentation to Jack Shaw, and while Shodo is doing that, I'm going to address my class really quick. So this concludes the presentation, and it also concludes our last lecture of the semester. So go ahead, Shodo.
Mr. Shaw, this is on behalf of the IS Club. We have 3D printed a KSU owl here.
Oh, great. Of course. Yeah, oh, so wonderful.
This is made on KSU campus.
Oh, very cool.
And then we also have a KSU Coles College of Business phone charger.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah. That'll be handy. Well, thank you very much. That's very nice. Well, that'll occupy a prominent place on my desk. That's very cool. Thank you so much.